So let's jump into it. Now, Bonson says that this may be the toughest chapter in his book, Against All Opposition. He says this one might lose people, is what he suggested. So he's kind of warning us ahead of time and asked us kind of stick with him until, you know, we can get the basics down. And this clearly, from his perspective, where he's coming from with regard to worldviews and that sort of thing, is the basics, is what we're going to cover today. He says he's going to show us how to start dismantling the unbeliever's worldview. But in order to do it well, he tells us, we're going to have to know what we're doing and what we're dealing with. So right. That's how he's kind of jumping us into this chapter. Right.
Yeah, so if you're kind of looking for the manual, all right, let's get to the meat and potatoes. You have to get, you're reading until chapter 7 to kind of get to the crossfire section. And so Bonson does a good job of showing out and laying out. It kind of reminds me of what we did for Dr. Anderson's Why Should I Believe Christianity? He builds it so slowly and well. To get to the main points, but you have to start with certain assumptions, certain ideas that you may not have thought of before or looked at before. And so that's what Bonson is here doing on just what is philosophy. And you might think, oh, you know, what do we care about? Oh, you know, are grasshoppers beautiful? Oh, like I should care about that. And he actually discusses something along those lines as well. So he says, I have told you that everyone has a worldview. You have one. The unbeliever has one. Again, that's why in the last two episodes, we talked about neutrality, not neutrality so much as, well, I don't really have an opinion on the subject, is that your underlying assumptions, you can't start with a neutral starting point. And so the short clips that we make on YouTube, said, oh, well, you know, you have to start with neutrality when you're talking about God. And that person was coming from a point of view of saying you have to start with no assumption on if there is or is not a God. And that's not the neutrality that's being talked about there. It's having neutrality on everything, including your basic assumptions. And so one of those things that Bonson says is that we can't be neutral on is as having a worldview. Now, yours might be underdeveloped, it might be overdeveloped, it might be inadequate. Think about children. They have what they're able to take in from their just personal experiences, but they always go to their parents and ask, well, why is this the case? And so you know, the joke of your children always asking you why until you get to some very philosophical points of view sometimes makes parents the best of all philosophers there.
Yeah. Well, kids are tiny philosophers as well. That's why they're asking questions.
That's right. And so you get to the point where you just go, well, because I don't know. Soon the facade will come down and they'll realize that we don't know everything. And that's when the rebellion starts. But when the unbeliever wants you to be neutral, he's trying to neutralize you to take away your worldview and then continue using his own, which amounts to winning the debate by default. The whole heads I win, tails you lose type of deal. He will not give up his or her presuppositions. It's impossible to do so. You must not give up your presuppositions. And again, this is something we want to point out. You can't do. It would be improper to do. And it would be, especially for Christians, immoral.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And so, you know, everyone has underlying philosophy, says Bonson tells us. And he talks about this. He thinks about an individual, he says, who says something like homosexuals can't help what they do, right? And Bonson tells us that on that view, human nature, dictators can't help what they do either. If that's the case, and you're not going to oppose homosexuality because they were made that way, then what gives you the right to oppose dictators, for instance, who were also made that way? And the point he's trying to make here is that the person who says this has a profound philosophy, but it's not a philosophy that's in agreement with itself, right? It's inconsistent. In other words, the only way it would be consistent is we'd have to treat both kinds of folks in the same way. And obviously this person isn't doing this by, you know, how they're characterizing their argument.
Right, right. And we could talk about this with serial killers as well. Well, sure, we might need to remove them from society so that they don't kill us all or kill, you know, who their intended victims are. But we can't judge them. I mean, they were born this way. There's a flaw. And to even call it a flaw is in of itself a presupposition, because right. Who's to say that the serial killer isn't the next level of human evolution to come about? And we've lived in some prosperity, and now it's time for the hard times, and we need the serial killers to come and round us and call the herd a little bit. But to then judge people based on varying other characteristics, well, why can't we just use the same basis there? So either there is choices, or there's by nature, and to not distinguish between two, even if you say that there's a mixture for some and a mixture for others, to just unqualify those as saying, oh, we need to take out dictators because they're acting immoral, but people that do other immoral things, I support those people. And so or I don't want to judge those people because I might be judged, or what have you there is where we run
into inconsistent. That. Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's what we want. And the whole process now, especially the political process of pointing this out. And I forget who I was listening to this week no one cares anymore about consistency, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't still do it, because we still, it might be preaching in the choir, but still the choir is there in the church to be preached to. And so we still need to talk about when people are being inconsistent, even if they claim that they don't care, because it's one of those things that I think Doug Wilson says that you can only exist in an unreality for so long until reality comes crashing into your face. And so,
right.
So that's what we're doing here.
You can only think the wall doesn't exist until you run into it.
Right. Yeah. Nose meat wall. Hi.
That's right.